In Ethiopia, there are springs of volcanic steam and hot water, rich with dissolved sulfur. In the sun's heat, the water evaporates, leaving the ground bright yellow. And something you can't fail to notice, there's a strong smell of rotten eggs, hydrogen sulfide. This used to be part of the Red Sea. Then volcanic ridges rose up and walled it off. So now it's a desert plain of sun-baked salt, a desert of sodium chloride. Life itself, looked at one way, is a complex structure of chemical substance. The things that are made by man, plastic-covered golf balls, packages of ingenious chemistry. Rubber, these days, even that can be made by man. 3 million different substances are known, yet the fact is this, whether plastics, petrol, or the stuff of flesh and blood, each one is itself made from a chemical construction kit containing just a few dozen different parts, the chemical elements.
There's antimony, arsenic, aluminum, selenium, and hydrogen, and oxygen, and nitrogen, and rhenium, and nickel, neodymium, neptunium, germanium, and iron, americium, ruthenium, uranium, europium, zirconium, lutetium, vanadium, and lanthanum, and osmium, and astatine, and radium, and gold, and protactinium, and indium, and gallium, and iodine, and thorium, and thulium, and thallium. There's yttrium, ytterbium, actinium, rubidium, and boron, gadolinium, niobium, iridium, and strontium, and silicon, and silver, and samarium, and bismuth, bromine, lithium, beryllium, and barium. There's holmium, and helium, and hafnium, and erbium, and phosphorus, and francium, and fluorine, and terbium, and manganese, and mercury, molybdenum, magnesium, dysprosium, and scandium, and cerium, and cesium, and lead, praseodymium, and platinum, plutonium, palladium, promethium, potassium, polonium, and tantalum, technetium, titanium, tellurium. and cadmium and calcium and chromium and curium. There's sulfur, californium, and fermium, berkelium, and also mendelevium, einsteinium, nobelium, and argon, krypton, neon, radon, xenon, zinc, and rhodium, and chlorine, carbon, cobalt, copper, tungsten, tin, and sodium. These are the only ones of which the news has come to Harvard. And there may be many others, but they haven't been discovered.
Phosphorus. It ignites just by being in contact with the air. Mercury. A metal that's liquid. Lithium, a metal that floats. Iodine, one of the elements that's vital to life. Without iodine, our thyroid glands couldn't work. For many living creatures, iodine is essential. If a tadpole's body doesn't contain iodine, it will never grow legs and become a frog. The elements. If you were counting during the song, there were 102, and since the song was recorded, a few more have been discovered. Four, in fact, and there may be more to come. As it happens, only 90 of them are found on Earth occurring naturally. The chemical elements are the building bricks of everything. Think about a sheep, and think what it does with the grass it eats. Sheep are wonderful chemists. They can turn grass into wool, they can turn grass into mutton, they can even turn grass into new sheep. Grass is not a chemical element, but it contains all the elements that sheep need. Like every living creature, the sheep really is a wonderful chemist. It takes the elements that make grass and rearranges them to make wool and mutton. It's rather like rearranging letters to make new words. Thousands of words from just a few letters. Letters are like the elements. Words are like the chemical compounds that are made from them. Water, hydrogen and oxygen, a chemical compound from two elements. Like a two-letter word, water is a two-element compound. Another is ordinary domestic salt. Salt is chlorine combined with sodium. Now, sodium is a metal, a strange metal as soft as cheese. And it's dangerous stuff, too. See what happens when water gets to it. Sodium certainly isn't safe to handle. And chlorine is a poisonous gas used with lethal effect in the First World War. How could two such nasty elements combine to form something as harmless and valuable as salt? Yet they can, and in this experiment we'll try to do precisely that piece of chemical magic. Safely inside a fume cupboard, chlorine gas is fed into the flask. Chlorine is heavier than air, so it sinks to the bottom. A further safety precaution, and then a piece of hot sodium is lowered inside. The sodium has burnt and combined chemically with the chlorine, and if the magic has worked, that white stuff should be ordinary salt. Only an experienced chemist should try this sort of thing, but here's the proof. On an industrial scale, salt is a valuable raw material. The sodium and chlorine are extracted by electrolysis. The chlorine from the salt finds its way into many useful things, especially PVC plastics. Washing up liquids and detergents are two products made using the sodium extracted from the salt. Ruby, another two-element compound. Ruby is aluminium oxide. The color comes from tiny impurities. It's an odd thought that precious stones can be made from aluminium and oxygen. This is aluminium powder. Dropped into a Bunsen flame, the aluminium burns. It combines chemically with the oxygen. The smoke is a cloud of aluminium oxide. Let's take powdered oxide and watch some magic. The stream of particles will be heated rapidly in a very hot flame. Let's see what happens. The gas is lit, and over a period of hours, the powder reforms to make a single crystal, a crystal of ruby. Crystals like this are grown in quantity to make gemstones for Swiss watch mechanisms. And there it is, a genuine man-made ruby. From here on, the story is simple. The ruby is cut up into pieces, then it's sliced into plates, chopped into squares, and then ground into tiny discs to make the hard-wearing jewel bearings for a wristwatch. But what are we made of? Are we made from simple chemicals like two-letter words? Well, partly yes, but most of the chemicals are big and complicated. Every human being alive is made from chemical compounds of many different elements. Oxygen, hydrogen, calcium, potassium, gases and metals to make flesh and blood. 24 different elements combine to make the very complex chemicals of the human body. The business of chemistry is trying to puzzle out the magic, why things are as they are, and how we can make use of them. Let's look more closely at the elements. The most obvious difference between them is that some, like gold, are metals, while others, like iodine, are not. In fact, the great majority of the elements are metals, over 80 of them, and only a small minority aren't. It's rather like the alphabet. Most of the letters are consonants, and there are just a few vowels. Among the metals, there are some which are very alike: cobalt, nickel, and iron, the three elements which can be magnetized. Gold, silver, and platinum are all very alike too. Jewelers use them because they don't corrode. They're not affected by the oxygen in the air. They don't react chemically with it. And towards the other extreme, there's lithium. Lithium reacts very vigorously with the oxygen in the water. Even more reactive is sodium, which we saw earlier. And here's potassium. Lithium, sodium, and potassium are all very reactive. They all combine enthusiastically with the oxygen in the water. They are not the same as each other, but they behave in similar ways. And there are six metals like that, a chemical family, the alkali metals. Now let's look at some of the non-metals. Airships filled with hydrogen were big business 40 or 50 years ago. At that time, they seemed much safer than aircraft.
The back motors of the ship are just holding it just enough to keep it from... It burst into flames. It's rising terrible. Oh, my, get out of the way, please. It's burning, bursting into flames, and it's falling on the going fast. All the folks between the ship is terrible. Four or 500 feet into the sky.
Hydrogen isn't safe. All it needed was one spark, and it reacted explosively with the oxygen in the air. Tragic proof of the enthusiasm of hydrogen and oxygen to react and do chemistry together. It was years before anyone dared to make airships again. The few there are these days are filled with helium. Helium is non-flammable and safe. In fact, helium is completely unreactive. Nothing, it seems, will make it do any chemistry at all. It's rather as if the alphabet contained the Greek letter pi. Try to make words with pi, and you can't. You might say that pi is a very unreactive letter of the alphabet. Pi, like helium, stays on its own. Helium is what chemists call an inert gas, and there are six of these, another chemical family. They do almost no chemistry and form almost no compounds. They're the least reactive of all the elements. They do have their uses, though. They glow with bright colours, for example, when electricity is passed through them. The lights of Piccadilly are there by courtesy of the inert gases. Argon gives blue, helium white, and neon gives red. There are other chemical families, but these two are enough to illustrate the point. The triangles, remember, represent the alkali metals. The picture is completed if we take one other factor into account. Each element has a number. It's different for each one of them, the atomic number. If we arrange them in order, starting with hydrogen at number one, we can hardly fail to notice something. The triangles and the circles come next to each other. There again. And you'll notice in a moment that they seem to come at regular intervals. Now, we'll keep them in order, but we'll line them up in rows. This is a kind of chemical map, the periodic table. It took 100 years for chemists to work out the details of this pattern. It certainly wasn't as straightforward as we've made it seem. But it's a very useful pattern, and some of the important features are clear to see. The triangles line up to form a family. These are the metals that combine enthusiastically with oxygen, the very reactive alkali metals. Lithium is at the top, sodium is next, and they get steadily more reactive as you go down. And on the other side of the table, the circles line up, the very unreactive family of inert gases. And something else. The magnetic elements come together in a group as well. And so do the jewellery metals, gold, silver, and platinum. And to complete that group, there are five other metals that are very unreactive too, metals that don't easily react with oxygen. And there's chlorine, the dangerous, poisonous gas. Next to it is fluorine, a gas that's even more vicious. Oddly enough, fluorine is an important constituent of the non-stick coating of modern cooking utensils. And chlorine is used in the manufacture of antiseptics and disinfectants, as well as in plastics. But the elements themselves, fluorine and chlorine, are highly reactive, and there are others with chemical properties that are very similar. Together, they form another chemical family, the halogens. And finally, the metals and non-metals divide the table neatly into two distinct areas, metals on the left. This neat table caused chemists in the past to think about why the elements come in families. Chemists today can understand the reasons, because they know about atoms and how atoms are built up. Atoms are the key to understanding the periodic table.
I hope you're all taking notes, because there's going to be a short quiz next period. There's antimony arsenic. arsenic, aluminum, selenium, and hydrogen, and oxygen, and nitrogen, and rhenium, and argon, krypton, neon, radon, xenon, zinc, and rhodium, and chlorine, carbon, cobalt, copper, tungsten, tin, and sodium. These are the only ones of which the news has come to Harvard. And there may be many others, but they haven't been discovered. Now, may I have the next slide, please? Carried away there.
Read on.